Harsha, everybody knows that you've been associated with a very, well, an ambulance service that people are talking about, right? Most recently, with the tragedy in Kalutara, there was a lot of people talking about it. Now, think it through. Tell me, this thing that you first rolled out in the southern province, then you brought to the western province, how could this play out if we had a sort of constitutional right to health, which may have been defined by the courts to include equal right to access to ambulances? Would it make your life easier or more difficult in rolling out this service?
Usually there is access to emergency healthcare, I guess you call it directive principle. Even though it is not a constitutional right, we've had access to emergency healthcare from day dot. And even though it is not specifically stated in the constitution, right to health and right to education has de facto been a right. And that is why we see demonstrations on the roads all over the country here in Sri Lanka seeking justice if a person is denied free health and free education. So it's a bit of a paradox in that sense. But coming to the specific issue, whether we should charge for the service that we provide or whether we should continue to give it free is a question that needs to be answered, because it costs us money per transfer of a critically ill patient. Since we started in August of last year, we've now crossed the 13,000 mark. 13,000 patients have been transferred to hospitals. Of that 13,000, I would hazard a guess, we would have saved maybe 500-600 lives at the least. Now, if they had, or if we had, or if we will in the future have, that right cast in stone in the Constitution, what still I'll face the same problems I face today. It won't make any difference to me. Because where is the money? Right? So the conditionality must acknowledge Arindam Bachi, the Deputy High Commissioner, because it is a grant from India that 7.8 million dollar grant from India that we've been able to do it. Of course, you remember all the hullabaloo at the beginning. And yesterday we were discussing with the Secretary of Foreign Affairs, Dr. Jayashankar, on expanding this to the entire country. And we will do that. We hope that we will receive the support of the government of India for phase two. And the government of Sri Lanka, let me publicly announce here, the Prime Minister has said that we, the government of Sri Lanka, will take on the entire responsibility of operating the ambulance service in the western and the southern province. And once, hopefully, this Indian grant comes to an end for phase two, the government of Sri Lanka will take over the responsibility. So it is the ability of financing, as at the end of the day, as an economist, what matters. So it is conditional upon. And that, what I agree with you is, what is the institutional framework that will deliver the outcome that that is enshrined in the Constitution as something free that you're going to get? So I don't know whether you got.
I'm just wondering, would there be some kind of problem? Perhaps even Pratap can come in. This was offered only in one district. It was piloted, it was tested, and then it was broadened. But even today, not everybody in Sri Lanka has access to it. Is there a problem here?
So the ambulance case is an interesting one, you know, because I wish we had this service in India, actually. There's going to be more demand for it. And it's an interesting problem, right? Because it does point to something important about how rights are understood. So one of my colleagues, Jishnu Das, who's one of the world's foremost experts on health, now at the World Bank, he has long been arguing in India that in India we've had a fixation about taking doctors to patients, not about taking patients to doctors. So you know this classic problem of remote areas, doctors don't go, primary health clinics are not well served. And his long advocacy was that we'd be far better off making small investments in ambulances than we were in trying to create these mega structures, right, in rural areas where they were not sustainable, right? But somehow a political, cultural understanding of what healthcare meant, right, meant that there was great pressure, right, to make that other choice rather than kind of experiment, let's say, with ambulances, right? Right? So in that sense, I think it's an interesting illustration of the point that Ambedkar was making, that what you need is a framework that allows this iterative learning. Now, the other problem that could happen, right, which is in a sense, is the scaling up problem, which is Indian courts have been very good at pronouncing rights. By and large, what has saved them is that they have been very timid about giving directions that have financial implications. There are some exceptions to this, but there have been, right? But technically, that's where the rule of law characteristic comes in. So imagine a situation where somebody files a right to equality suit in the court saying, six districts have it, it hasn't reached us. This is actually discrimination, right? Now, if courts end up adjudicating that claim, right? So they might say yes. There will be a choice you have to make in terms of allocating resources. And the question is, are courts in a better position to make that choice, or should it be left to legislatures?
If I may, I mean, people in this country would remember how a particular gentleman representing a particular association once came on television and said, don't get in these ambulances. Do not. Right, and then consider the situation here. It is given free. It is essential. You can die, you can save a life, but yet for certain political reasoning, it was suggested that one should not get inside this ambulance. But on the other hand, now, in Parliament, I hear frequently when people speak on matters related to healthcare, members from Trincomalee district would get up and say, please, could you provide us with this service? Members from Ratnapura district would get up and say regularly.
So that's the political process.
This is what I'm saying. Exactly. So let it be a democratic process. And this iterative learning that you spoke about earlier, Pratap, that is what we require. And so if we went to court at the beginning, or if that was enshrined in the Constitution and somebody said, look, I need emergency medical care, then how would you even be able to think about an institutional framework to provide this outcome? So it is, I believe, it's a better outcome that we now have and a sustainable one at that.
Now, I'm going to ask both of you to address a question that I kind of picked up several years ago, the UPA under Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. The overall logic of the Indian political culture at that time seemed to be to institutionalize various rights. So you began with the right to information, right to income, so to speak, livelihood, the NREGA. Then they were talking about various other kinds of rights. Now, so when I look at the first one of that series, where India has made quite an impression, particularly on us, right to information. Now, I don't know, Pratap, whether you know, but we just, beginning of this month, our Act, Right to Information Act, came into force. Now, I would be the first one to say, having run a government department, we don't have the institutional capability to deliver the kind of problem that you said. You give people a right, but the institutional machinery isn't there. One of the arguments that can be made is you give the right, and will that not create the institutional regime? Perhaps both of you can address the sort of the counterexample to what you were talking about.
I mean, let's take the Foreign Office for example. We have staff that are in files for 40 years, and it's, you know, in some warehouse somewhere. And the question that Mangal and I had was, you know, what capability do we have to be able to give this information out in a X number of hours when a citizen requests for this information? So then we started thinking about it, and then, of course, we had to agree that we had to change the way we were doing things, re-engineering the entire processes. So I guess having that sort of legal responsibility to be able to find a file from some 20 years ago forces you to think about a system, a more efficient system, to deal with that situation. So I think, it forces you to do that, which is a good thing.
So two things. So the right to information was an extraordinary achievement. I mean, it really, and one of the things that I think makes it extraordinary is because its focus is on the right thing, right? Its focus is on saying what is an instrument we can give the people that will actually empower them to hold their governments accountable, right? So in that sense, it's actually, you might put it this way, it's a small investment with a very, very large payoff in governance terms, right? I mean, it changes, right? And in order for that to be meaningful, it would have had to be made a right? That's the very kind of nature of it. I think the other rights, I think are different. So the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, which guaranteed a certain number of working days employment to every rural household in India, right? I know it has a lot of critics. I'm actually a supporter of that, as this government is also turning out to be kind of after much delay, right? Because it tried to address sort of two problems. One, give us social safety net, right? And remember, one of the things about that makes that right feasible and enforceable is the fact that it very clearly defines a minimum core to that right, right? So think of let's say a social economic right, which simply said right to work, as opposed to saying a right to work for 60 days at a specified wage rate, right? And the cost of doing that program is actually less than the cost of subsidizing Air India. I mean, which is a big scandal should be a big scandal for Indian politics, right? But it's an example of, it is a right, but it also has the legislative framework underneath it, right? That actually makes it a very clearly specifiable and effective right, right? And that's really the point, in a sense, I was actually making. And if you look at the rights that were successful under UPA, it was not just the promulgation of the rights, it was whether under that right you actually articulated the conditions that would attach to that right as clearly as possible. Otherwise, you will give the courts a field day to just go all over the place.
But the point there is, Pratap, you know, is there the institutional mechanism in place all over India to be able to deliver that outcome to the billions of...
So RTI has actually been remarkably successful on the whole. I mean, everything is a kind of relative story in some ways, right? But I think its reach, and as you said, its ability to kind of transform governance practices. Now, I mean, there is this worry about, you know, who determines what information should be revealed, whether people are actually hiding things because You know, I mean, there are ways of working the system, and there will always be people gaming the system in some ways, right? But building RTI response capacity turned out not to be as big a challenge as I think many of the critics of RTI actually feared.
So you may know that, we are taking questions on one of these automated systems. I've looked at the questions that have come in. I'll answer one. The question is, are you taking questions only on this mechanism, or will you give me a microphone? I'll give you a microphone if you want, right? So it's not exclusive. We'll run two tracks. You want to come this way, or you want to come with a microphone, we'll do both. The questions that I have received, you guys can also look at the thing. Supposedly there's some voting also involved here, right? So if you sign into this thing and you click the side icon, you can say that question is popular, I want to ask that question also, then it rises. So the one that I answered is the most popular. Oh no. Is the government's effort to constitutionalize socioeconomic rights an acknowledgement that the Sri Lankan state has failed, like South Africa? That's the one which has the most popular question right now.
As I said, my reading of the demands for constitutionalization is that this is a response to state failure, right? It is precisely because we ended up in a situation where our legislatures and executives came to be delegitimized or were not seen to be delivering. We therefore think that a legal ordering can be an answer to that question. Now, Sri Lanka has done much better than India, by the way, right? So on a whole range of educational and health achievements. So failure is in a sense a relative term. But the question to ask is, so many countries have achieved high outcomes without constitutionalizing that right. And I think there's a lesson to sort of remember there, that this is neither a necessary condition nor a sufficient condition. It may turn out that at a certain moment in a democratic conversation, people think it'll just exert enough pressure, right, to get lawmakers to move. I mean, one of the good things of having this debate is that even if the right doesn't get constitutionalized, right, it might actually force lawmakers to kind of preempt, you know, courts, in order to prevent courts from taking over, to actually do something about the matter.
Yeah, I mean, so I just got a printout of the fundamental rights chapter in the existing constitution, which is 3 pages, and that 3 pages or three, oh, sorry, about 5 pages, and a page and a half was added recently, 19th amendment to the constitution with the right to information. This is the subcommittee report on fundamental rights. So this is some 20 odd pages. So if you just measure by the number of pages, the additional rights that have come in, you know, or rather the subcommittee is proposing, is massive, huge amount of new rights that are going to be contained in the Bill of Rights, including, of course, the right to life, which is not specifically mentioned in the current constitution. I would not want to call it a failure of the state. I mean, like I said earlier, even though it is not enshrined in the constitution, right to education and right to health, right to, of course, this is in the constitution, labor rights, some of the labor rights. You know, we as a country have enjoyed these rights. So if one says that Sri Lanka should also be then categorized as, say, South Africa, and say it is because the South African state failed, and therefore we need to enshrine these social and economic rights in the constitution, I would disagree. Because Sri Lanka, I don't know how many other countries are like Sri Lanka, but I think Sri Lanka has been unique in that sense, in terms of social rights, and even the development, social development index and so on, have ranked Sri Lanka way up along with developed countries almost. So therefore, I would not consider the two cases similar.
Just a clarification on this. So Sri Lanka has done well, as you know, Minister said. I mean, it's, you know, it used to be and still is, in a sense of, you know, example to India on a lot of these indicators, right? I think the specific puzzle, therefore, right, is what is the pressure? Because one of the things constitutionalization of rights does, as I said, its inevitable effect is to give courts more power. And I think that's the specific puzzle. It's, you know, it's not, I mean, you know, right, you can use rights language without, for example, making it justiciable. You can use, make rights language very much part of your normal political discourse, which in a healthy democracy you should have, right? Even when we petition to ministers, we should do it as a matter of our right, right? The specific institutional question is, when you constitutionalize rights, right, is there a danger that it may actually empower the judiciary more, right? And I think that's, I think, the puzzle people are having, which is that given that Sri Lanka was actually doing relatively well on this, what is the pressure to actually constitutionalize? I mean, this is a question. This is just a, you know.
So, now, the second most popular question, I'm not going to take the first most popular question, I'm going to read it and I'm saying I'm not going to allow it, right? Why has no action been taken on Arjuna Mahendran? Come on, guys. We don't need to deal with that in under this subject, right? So leave that aside. You can blame me for not bringing that up. Second most popular question, Dr. Harsha, to what extent have we looked at constitutionalizing socioeconomic rights in the new constitution? How does it differ from the existing one? But I'm going to, now that Harsha, you brought up the subcommittee report, I'm going to ask you to focus on a particular line in that. It says that action or fundamental right applications may be lodged against, we can go to the exact language if we want, state as well as non-state actions, which suggests that a company, or even, I mean, since non-state action has not been defined, even an individual or a little retail shop, not a legal entity, could be subject to fundamental rights applications. Now, I find that very disturbing. Do you?
Well, what are these rights? I mean, there are some, for instance, let's take a specific case, evictions in Colombo. A lot of people have been talking about evictions in Colombo. I mean, I think those things are ripe to be legislated. And people should have the right to argue their case in a court of law, because evictions used to happen in a very inhumane way, right? Violating the rights of people. Now, suppose what I'm trying to do is to link that. It's a private company that is building an apartment complex, right? And it, they are evicting people who have had encroached on their property. That was a very interesting case, because when I, with some others, sort of brought this up during the previous regime, they said that the National Involuntary Resettlement policy is applied if the funding came from the World Bank. If the funding came from some other place, that was not relevant. So my question then was, that's a hell of a situation, right? So if it is state, because the state borrowed from the World Bank, and the World Bank was building something, some people were evicted, they were given money or whatever it is that they were entitled to. In another case, a Chinese company was building an apartment complex and they were evicted, but they were given nothing. Now, in that case, I guess the state and the non-state situation perhaps could come to play.
But we come to this. If we can agree that evicting people without compensation, with just evicting them onto the street, is not a good idea. Should it be in the constitution? Should it be through constitutional remedy? Or should there be other remedies? That's the question.
In my view, I think I have been arguing for a long time that the national involuntary resettlement policy must be legislated. Now, whether it should go into the constitution or not is a question that can be debated in this democracy and determined as to, you know, where it belongs. But there must be legislation, right? So whether it is directive principles of the state or whether it is in the constitution or whether it is whatever it is, it must be legislated and people must be able to pursue a case if they are evicted without compensation.
Now, I think this is a very important point. So one of the things from the Indian experience that I think is worth pondering about, which is once things get constitutionalized, it has one of the perverse effects is that it actually weakens other kinds of remedies and other areas of law. So the core point that the minister is making is absolutely spot on, that you do need a effective, enforceable framework to govern things like evictions, provide remedies of all kinds, right? So one of the things you find in India, for example, just to take an example, that once the Supreme Court declared something to be a right, which is in a sense constitutionalized, even normal administrative action or normal tort claims came to be thought of as right claims. So you know, let's say negligent behavior on part of a private medical party, right? That certainly should be amenable to some kind of remedy. But one of the downsides of constitutionalizing was that the courts by and large read everything as rights claims rather than saying, okay, here's a tort remedy available, here's an administrative law remedy available, here's a possible contract law remedy available. You know, in the case of private companies, presumably there are conditional grants under which they operate, right? And what you find is actually jurisprudence getting blunter and blunter. I mean, I think in a good regulatory society, you require that judicial discipline to make those fine-grained distinctions. But I think the central point remains that you need some framework to, you know, address these kinds of problems.
Okay, we have a question which is going back to the health issue, which I think is a fascinating right to make justiciable. The question is, we see patients being asked to get most of their medicines from outside pharmacies. This is in our free health system from the government hospitals. Doctors blame government for not allocating sufficient funds. Will this continue? Under constitutionalization, under this new right to health, what will happen is what the questioner is asking, not me.
Yeah, but then I don't know if I know very, very, very little about constitutions, Pratap, and I don't have sort of any knowledge of comparative constitutions. But it would be strange if somebody wrote a constitution without any conditionality. Yeah. And say universally for everyone, you know, you get dialysis treatment forever. Now, you know, so that's the kind of question that we need to answer. And those are the conditionalities that need to be clearly laid out. And otherwise, then it becomes a matter for some judge somewhere, I guess judges of the Supreme Court to determine, to interpret that constitution. And that may not necessarily be something that could or would be economically feasible or viable. So therefore, it is very dangerous, I think, to have these rights enshrined in the constitution without conditions that are plausible.
When the government cannot deliver basic rights under the current constitution, such as equality before the law, let's interrogate that part of the question. Then we go to the second part. Is the new constitution a smokescreen? That's a question from the floor. So first, has our current constitution failed to deliver basic rights and such as equality before the law?
I mean, the whole thing is, you know, civil and political rights versus economic and social rights. So where is that equality coming to play? Of course, I believe in that. I believe that every person must have the same opportunities as every other person. Right? That's how I view equality. Now, the whole country knows the kind of debate we had in cabinet about discrimination on sexual orientation. Now, that one becomes difficult to agree on in our society. And if we put that in the constitution as a right, then what the repercussions of that? Either way, I don't know. You know, how are we going to deal with that? I don't know. I tried to, and I got hammered left, right, and center. So I shut up, right? but you know, some rights, you know, equality before the law, are going to be difficult to implement than some other rights of equality. So I don't have the answer to your question.
There's a kind of a connected question, which. Yes. There's a connected question which isn't, which doesn't have a lot of votes, but because it's connected, I'll ask it. What's wrong with evictions going to the constitution? It restrains the state. Can it not prevent laws like UDA laws being enacted in the first place? So they're looking at, I mean, it's a very concrete situation. UDA is Urban Development Authority, which has very powerful rights over eminent domain and taking over land and zoning and so on. So the questioner wants some kind of constitutional constraints, I suppose, on the existing laws.
So there's a couple of sort of facets to this. One, I think just taking off from the answer to the previous question, that, you know, discrimination, to my mind, is actually not a socioeconomic right in the sense that we are discussing. I mean, discrimination, anti-discrimination laws are the basic moral bedrock of any constitutional system. Right, I mean, which is people should not be denied something that everybody else has access to simply because of who they are, right? Not because of what they do. I mean, that's a, you know, you don't have a liberal or a political or a basic, you know, if that. So in that sense, discrimination has always been classed in a separate kind of category. I think the eviction story is an interesting one, and you know, there the Indian experience is very instructive, right? We have an absolutely abominable record on evicting people and resettling, rehabilitating them. Interestingly, it was facilitated by, as I said, the weakening of the right to property, right? There are two ways of doing it. One is you can actually have a very strong property rights culture, right? Where the state cannot easily exercise the power of eminent domain. If it exercises the power of eminent domain, it has to pass a very stringent definition of public purpose. Our courts became very lax in allowing pretty much anything as public purpose, right? So that's one way of protecting it. I think the second problem which you have, and I think for property rights holder that works. I think in India you had a second problem which is a very different character. Probably Sri Lanka probably has less of it, but which is, what about the rights of people who do not have property, right? So this is migrants to cities, you know, payment dwellers, for example, who cannot use property rights protections against evictions. In rural India, landless labor. So typically when compensation awards were given, you know, if I had a title, I could claim a compensation award, right? And that's why we've come up with a much more sophisticated rehabilitation and resettlement norms and policies, right? Now, I think you need a combination of things. A, you need adequate due process in any of these decisions, right? For example, when you give permissions to build, is there an adequate social impact assessment, right? You could do it through that means if you had the state administrative machinery to do it. So all I'm saying is that, you know, that one, that the problem or the challenge of dealing with evictions is a fundamental moral challenge for societies like ours. But you can think of lots of remedies short of constitutionalization that are actually more effective. And, I mean, there's a reverse danger, remember. In societies, I think this is true more of India probably than Sri Lanka, where you actually have under-enforcement anyway, there is a great danger that if you actually over-constitutionalize, people will find informal and possibly even more brutal ways of dealing with it. Right? So you have to think of that institutional architecture seriously.
I think just want to emphasize the distinction, right? The right to property, which again is somewhat controversial. I think many people will be for the right to property, but there are some who don't like it. The right to property would only give compensation and safeguards for those with property. While your case from Bombay was for a squatter. While a right to shelter or right to housing would protect those people as well. So we are making the distinction between those two, right? Yeah.
So my question is to you, Dr. Mehta, about Brazil. My understanding is that a lot of socioeconomic rights are hard-coded into the constitution, but that has a force, very high tax rate. That tax to GDP rate in Brazil is somewhere like 35 to 40%. Now, we have a problem in Sri Lanka where we have a very low tax to GDP. So we have been giving a lot of socioeconomic benefits, but funded it through borrowings. And we've been running large fiscal deficits, and we have come to a point where we can't sustain it anymore. Can you give some kind of insights of what kind of fiscal burden it has placed on governments, whether through this mechanism it has increased it? And also talk a little bit about, you know, the rights that are given through a constitution, but what about the responsibilities people have to enjoy those rights, like paying taxes and working hard and etc. to sustain this economically?
So you've hit at the core of the problem, right? Which is the two essential preconditions, right, of realizing most social economic rights are you need a growing economy in the first place, right, that generates the resources. And then the state should have the ability to tap into some of these resources via taxation at a reasonable level, you know, to be able to provide for these rights and so forth, right? Now, one of the reasons I was expressing a little bit of skepticism about kind of using simply constitutional or legal means to doing it is that juridification is not an answer to both of those fundamental questions, right? And Indian courts have been caught in this dilemma, as I said, which is they pronounce the right very strongly. Right, and you know, legal scholars all over the world, the Indian Supreme Court is the darling, right, of the social rock economic rights legislation. But then one of two things happens. Either they have to face reality, and as I said, the remedies. Now, technically, courts have argued that the state cannot come to the court and simply use lack of finances as an excuse for delivering on a right. That still remains a formal doctrine. That's not feasible. So essentially, they pronounce these rights without actually giving you those remedies. Right? I mean, that's what I meant, that juridification can produce rule by courts, but it does not necessarily produce rule of law. Right? In fact, it increases skepticism towards the rule of law. The core question which you raise, which I happen to think cannot have a constitutional answer, is what is the optimum rate of taxation and what is the appropriate enforcement mechanism, right, for generating those taxes. I mean, I think it is true that sort of Brazil is, you know, Latin American countries have been kind of locked in, right, to certain levels of spending. And therefore, it gives them less macroeconomic flexibility sometimes, right? Which is why I, on balance, I mean, while I can see the moral pressure that constitutionalizing right exerts, I actually think it's only a very small part of solving that larger problem, which has to do with how does the state generate the resources in the first place, right? And it's interesting that almost nobody, none of us, would vote for, as it were, an enforceable obligation for a minimum level of taxation. We want that to be negotiated through our politics, right? Which tells us something about us as citizens.
Now, Harsha, you're on the subcommittee on finance related to the Constitution. Any thoughts on this from that perspective?
I mean, I think we should have in the Constitution right for the Treasury to impose a certain amount of tax on every working person. This is the reality, right? So that is why a lot of these constitutions still anyway have the towards progressive realization, because, you know, yes, we believe these are good things, but progressively we will realize these objectives at some point in time. Because, you know, we can, you know, like someone said, you know, operation successful, patient dead. So there is no point in such rights. It just makes no sense, right? So I'm not trying to run away from the fact that we need to address these issues. We need to give these rights to the citizens of this country. But practically, you know, there are so many constraints, and we have to be realistic about how much we put in the Constitution as rights that we can deliver as a government. Because what will then happen is we put it there. A lot of rhetoric, you know, we say, look, we've done this, but if we are not able to deliver, then people will turn around and say, fail state. So it's, you know, two sides of the same coin.
I have questions from here.
My question is, constitutionalizing socioeconomic rights, we mean increase the delivery from the legislators or the government. Whether this kind of constitutionalization will reduce the moral social accountability of the legislators, because it should come out of their accountability towards their constituency or the people to do more, to make more outcome. But everything, if you put into the papers, will it diminish or improve?
You live through this.
No, I mean, can you dichotomize, you know?
Yeah.
You know, sort of legislation and the judicial process, you know, is it part of the democratic process, or is it something else? I don't know. I mean, you're the philosopher. but what is sustainable is what is generated, I think, internally, what people want. The social, the moral obligation that you mentioned very correctly, right? So if you are just being forced to do something, you know, what is the lifespan of that? People will look at options to get out of a situation that you're forced to be in. But if you are doing it because you want to do it, and there is justification, there is moral authority, there is democratic right that people vote for it, right, then it has a longer life. Then it becomes sustainable. So I think whatever we put in this new constitution must be what we all agree as a people. That is, I think, where I will leave it.
Actually, my question is to Dr. Mehta and Dr. Harsha both. Actually, it's a bit of a philosophical question. Rather than focusing on the implications of incorporating socioeconomic rights in a constitution, wouldn't it be a little innovative if we have an obligation incorporating the constitution to periodically maybe review the requirements of socioeconomic aspects? For example, I mean, as a legislature, you can, if you have an obligation, then what I feel is periodically this process will come into being, and that way certain pressing issues, like for example, if you take the SITEM issue currently, I mean, personally, I believe there is a right to education, and what's going on is absolutely, not fair. So from that perspective, wouldn't there be an obligation to take pressing issues on a periodic basis, one, and secondly, whether a similar mechanism exists in anywhere in the world? Thank you.
So, I mean, you're right. I mean, the core of any effective policy, whether you do it through constitutionalization, legislation, or ordinary policy, has to be responsiveness to circumstances, and therefore you need a review mechanism. And I'll just give one example in the education thing because it's live in India, shows where things can go kind of off wrong, right? So we got a right to education. It specifies a right to education for certain ages, right? 5 to 14, right? Now it turns out that you have a huge deficit in learning outcomes. And those learning outcomes are in part a consequence of the disparities in preschool education, right? Let's say educators tell you that. Now, one of the interesting consequences of constitutionalizing this right is that it's actually prevent even schools that want to take kids preschool, right? Particularly kids from poorer communities, so that they can actually bring them up to a certain level, let's say by grade one, right? Are actually being prevented from doing so because the framework that's been laid out, right, for admissions to particular schools prevents that. Now, here's an example of, if you like, in a sense, creating an architecture that has so many rules built into it, right, that the principle actually becomes more obscure, right? And ideally, what you would have wanted is a review back. Now, sometimes courts are good at doing it. You can go back to the court and say, here's a review petition. Can we make this modification in your order? Sometimes it doesn't. But the empirical working of the courts, I mean, that's why the judicial culture that a country has, what standards judges use, right? How quick are review petitions heard, right? That is actually very important to creating the kind of process that you have in mind.
Yeah, my question follows right on that. Can you talk a little bit about the court processes that countries like South Africa and Brazil instituted after guaranteeing these rights? Because in Sri Lanka, the fundamental rights cases are very delayed, take forever. Would Sri Lanka need to have a completely new, overhauled court process if the socioeconomic rights were to be guaranteed?
So there turns out to be a very large institutional variation, and usually the institutional variation kind of mirrors other forms of institutional variation. So I understand, for example, some countries, the pressure of right to health cases was such that they had to create special benches and tribunals just to deal with that. Now, that turns out also to be in part a function of your prior policy. So just to give one example, India has by and large managed to keep cost of drugs low. Some would argue it should even be lower, but basic drugs. Because the state did a lot of preemptive regulation, right? It allowed generic production, right? Some Latin American countries, a lot of right to health cases basically became access to drug cases. Right, I can't afford a drug, who do I go to? So essentially the courts were giving constant administrative remedies because you couldn't get access, and so you had literally tens of thousands of cases. India's actually avoided those cases because you actually have a preemptive policy that keeps prices of drugs low, right? So what those forms of litigation will be, right, depends, as I said, on that specific policy architecture that you actually put under it. But by and large, developing countries in general have a serious problem of judicial delays, non-implementation. The bigger question, which India is facing is, what happens if the government doesn't follow court orders, right? Look, fundamentally, you do have to rely on the government. And the Indian courts have actually been very reticent in passing contempt orders, right? Because they actually don't, right? So one of the arguments is that you have to rely on the government anyway, right? Right now, there's a very interesting case actually of great interest to Sri Lanka. This is a new rights. So the Indian constitution, by the way, in the text of the constitution, doesn't have a right to privacy. The Supreme Court created a right to privacy. The government is contesting whether or not there is a right to privacy in the Indian constitution. And this is the single biggest constitutional case because it involves this Aadhaar, this new digital identification that India is introducing, right? Where there's no privacy framework governing it. The court mandated that the government could not make Aadhaar compulsory in the absence of that framework, right? The government has gone ahead and done it anyway for a number of services. Contempt petition gets filed in the court. The court is now nicely avoiding taking up its, you know, it says doesn't need to be fast-tracked. It's already been 18 months since that contempt petition was filed, which is essentially the court saying, you know, look, if it really comes down to it and the executive and legislator don't want to do it, we really can't compel them. Right? And which is why I think one should temper the confidence in judiciary's ability to bring out
that. I just want to comment on the question earlier. Now, this is the National Human Rights Action Plan, which and has an entire chapter on economic and social rights. Since we were on education, so this is what the cabinet approved. And this has become now the National Action Plan. Now, inclusive and equitable quality education for all is one goal that we have agreed to work towards. Now, if you go to a particular objective in that is to all schools to be given equal status and systems developed to counter disadvantages. Now that is a particular objective. Now the activity is to implement, among others, existing norms specified by the Minister of Education on physical facilities and teaching cadre, and strengthen the scheme of equipping at least 2 secondary schools in every divisional secretariat division with advanced level science labs, a computer center, adequate library, workshop, and hostel. Now, the relevant lead agency, the Ministry of Education. When we are supposed to meet those objectives, the completion target date is a long-term target. And the performance is increased facilities on the one hand, scheme in place, a number of schools with advanced level science labs installed. So these come up for periodic review. Now, it is going to be very difficult to put these periodic reviews in a constitution as a right, but it becomes possible in other ways to make that periodic review happen by having legislative frameworks that makes the government responsible in meeting these targets. I was just giving you an example of many.
Can I just make one point on this education? This is just to give an example of the kinds of things, right? So one of the things, and again, maybe of relevance to the Sri Lankan debate, the same judgment in India that pronounced a right to education also said that because education is right, not for-profit education cannot be allowed in India. Now, anybody who knows the Indian education scene knows it's dominated by private players, right? But we are all maintaining this fiction, right? That's the interpretation the court meant. It said, if it's a right, how can it be subject to profit? Now, it's a mystery why the court thinks food can be subject to profit, health can be subject to profit, but education cannot, right? But it goes to the point I'm making, in the sense that specifying the character of that right and what institutional implications it had is going to be important, because otherwise somebody is going to fill that vacuum. And I'd rather that the executive and legislator do it than the courts do it.
Professor, I take your point that incorporating some of these rights in the Constitution can be problematic because either there is no institutional framework for it or the scope is just too broad. But shouldn't we be aspiring to something better? Yeah. And I realize the Constitution is not meant to be an aspirational document, but if you don't incorporate things like, I don't know, say right to shelter or right to education, a lot of people may not even believe that they have those rights. So shouldn't we, in some manner or form, maybe have a conditional right in there, maybe where it's more, the scope is narrower, or it's within the current legislative framework or within the current laws, where people can have those rights?
I completely agree with you. I mean, I'm in this kind of odd situation that in terms of the substantive goals we should set for ourselves, I want our democracies to be much more ambitious, right? And frankly, we have no choice but to be ambitious, right? I mean, it's not a question of, you know, can somebody choose to be ambitious or not? As Minister will, I'm sure, testify, the demands bubbling from below, right, will compel us to respond to them, right? Everybody, you know, education, health. I think the really tricky challenge all our economies are going to face is what is the structure of social protection you have in an era of jobless growth, right? Where you can have growth, but you know, the employment elasticity of growth, right? So aspirationally, we have to be very high. And there is a value in putting that into the Constitution as kind of expressive aspirations, right? The only point at which I'm skeptical is A, whether making them justiciable by courts, as I said, is a necessary and sufficient condition of achieving those aims. And my kind of limited understanding of comparative experience suggests that we sometimes underestimate the way in which making it justiciable can actually produce some kind of perverse consequences, right? If there's a thread being running to what I'm saying is that we need to have higher aspirations for our democratic process. And if you have higher aspirations for that process, then both the substantive outcomes and the procedural infirmities will be addressed, right? But what you can't do, or what is dangerous for democracy, is saying somehow a judge will find you a shortcut, right, to that very ambitious goal we need.
One more.
Yeah.
You want to follow? Sure.
Yes. Let's say we do have faith in the democratic process.
Have you given her a mic?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What if some party comes to power where they feel, you know, you don't have a right to education, or you don't have a right to shelter? So people who have been evicted, they are on the street unless they are able to find employment, and maybe they are struggling to find employment and they remain on the street. Depending on the party that is in power and their policies and their beliefs.
So just a quick response to that. You know, there's a saying, I think, attributed to the, you know, the German legal theorist Jürgen Habermas, that effective law happens only when law and society meet each other halfway. So if we do become the kind of people that vote these parties to power, it's very unlikely a judiciary will save. In fact, the judiciaries have not been able to save us even on civil rights often, right? An area which is supposed to be the core of their competence. So judiciaries can operate in a sense in that marginal space, right? And I would not place greater burdens on them for that. I mean, if the scenario you describe comes to pass, then we are in such deep trouble, I doubt a judiciary could save us.
What about in the US, for example, the president brought in certain laws that took away people's rights to work there, they got rid of certain foreigners, but the judiciary actually protected the rights of those people, because they deemed it unconstitutional.
Yeah, I mean, that's a tough, I mean, the thing is, first, right has to be put in the Constitution. And only if that is a right under the Constitution, then you have recourse to a judiciary. So first, it is a democratic decision to make that a right, right? And then only others follow. Now, for instance, if we were to pass a new constitution, get a new constitution, and if we were to adopt the subcommittee on fundamental rights, that Bill of Rights, on right to education, there are four things. Every person has the right to education. Two, primary and secondary education shall be compulsory and shall be provided free by the state. Three, tertiary education shall be provided free by the state to all on the basis of capacity and equitable opportunity, which shall be progressively realized. And four, nothing in this article shall exclude the right of a lawful guardian of a child acting on that child's behalf or of any adult to select an education provided by a private institution of education, whether denominational or otherwise. So that sort of covers the right to education either for payment or paid for by others. So that's a very comprehensive.
So you're comfortable with that language going into the Constitution?
I mean, it provides the space for the receiver of that education to either get it via his or her or their parents' own means or by the taxes that other people pay that will be utilized to provide you with quote-unquote free education.
So this is a very interesting example, and you know it's very nicely framed, but here's my prediction of what's going to happen 10 years down the line, okay, with this clause. It's a debate India is facing right now, which is if the state discharges its responsibilities faithfully, right, it creates a good public school system, this clause will turn out to be an optimal win-win, right? People who don't have the resources go to government schools, get a good education. People who don't have resources go to private schools and still get a good education. Now think of a scenario where the state satisfies all the input criteria, right? But teachers don't show up to teach. There are very few learning outcomes, or learning outcomes in government schools become poor. Poor parents then begin to say, which is really the dilemma India is facing right now, I have this right, I even have a school I can sell my child to, but I know my child will still be at a disadvantage if I go to that public school. Now, it's debatable whether they are not, but let's stipulate that they are, right? So 7 to 10 years down the line, you have, despite having that right, reproduce the very inequity that the right was meant to address. So what it will take to make this right effective is putting that administrative pedagogical machinery in the public system, right? Where poor parents don't feel it's a choice. They actually have to exercise, right? And that was really in a sense my point that. And I think this is what basically happened in India. We declared victory at the level of constitutionalization. And now that pressure to address this inequity that has been produced despite that right still remains.
Yeah, I mean, then the question is, to what detail would you go in the Constitution?
I would not put it in the Constitution.
Exactly. That's why I go back to where I read out a part of the National Plan for Protection and Promotion of Human Rights, where there is another mechanism by which progressively you can review the outcomes in order to ensure that what is enshrined in the Constitution as that right is actually delivered on the ground by the parties it is supposed to be delivered by.
I went through pretty much all the highly voted questions, but I'm going to jump the queue for one, just because I got to have some fun. That fun is somebody wants to know, when are we going to get the right to the internet and broadband? And since I have answered this question in public, anybody can see that online, I'd like to see what you guys say about it. A right to internet in the Constitution of Sri Lanka.
It's even more fundamental than the right to life these days, right?
Harsha, no flip answers. Come on, give me a serious answer.
You should ask Trump first.
Well, they're not being very helpful. So I had to say this. When this came up, right to internet, I actually pointed out that today we have more homes with mobile phones than with sewing machines. Right? So I said, if we were drafting this law in the old days, would we have enshrined a right to sewing machines? Because I think this is a technology, right? Should we have enshrined a right to sewing machines? I mean, internet, you know, why not telepathy?
Yeah, so right? I think that's where it's
getting too much detail.
Yeah, yeah, right to information, I think, covers your internet, your every technology that one may utilize to deliver that information to you, whether you ask for that information or if whether that information is pushed to you. I think you can cover it in that right to information.
You know, Sri Lanka, we are almost at the stage of, I think we are there, 100% of households have the ability, that is, we have taken grid electricity to all the major human settlements. On January 8th, we went to Lankagama, which is the last remaining place, right? That doesn't mean that everybody has electricity, but it means that they can get it. The right to access has been provided. And one of the things that I keep saying is these kinds of things that are not treated like education and health, we are doing better under commercial terms with people paying and commercial provision, no freebies, than the ones that we say education is not a commodity, yeah, but not everybody is getting it. Health is not a commodity, but not everybody is getting it. We are not successful in giving things outside the market framework. While in electricity and telecommunications, we are doing pretty well. Your reactions?
So look, part of it, you know, as you know, part of it is the nature of the technology, right? I mean, which is that there may be just certain things. I think the comparison that commodified form versus non may be too simple. I mean, there just may be things that are easier to distribute, right? I think the paradox of free internet, in India we had this debate, which is, private companies are willing to give free internet. I mean, Facebook launched this, you know, free internet campaign, which was sort of the regulator had to kind of shut it down because it came at the, some people thought, at the price of giving a quasi-monopoly to a private company. Now, we can debate whether that was the right choice to make or not, but what's interesting is that you're not just making a choice about providing a particular good. You're also making a choice about what is the architecture of institutional dependence that you as a democratic society are comfortable with, right? If Reliance Jio, let's say India's largest telecom company, today, tomorrow came and offered X amount of free internet to everybody, but we get all your data. Is that a social contract you're willing to live with, right? So that's the kind of question that I think, you know, you'll have to debate. Sort of, even the free right comes, there is a cost attached to it. And you may very well swallow that cost, but I think it's worth having a debate about it.
Well, one last question. Can somebody get a mic to that gentleman in the back?
Hi. This is very interesting, but I wonder what you guys think about the conflation that the average Sri Lankan, that I feel, makes between rights and entitlements. What I feel the quintessential Sri Lankan confuses the two, and for instance, doesn't appreciate that a right is a capacious space with obligations and conditions inherently attached. But I think even this literal Sinhala translation of the word right tends to imply it's something that you should receive without obligation. So once we take a lot of the rights we talked about today, and once we enshrine them in the Constitution, what do you think this will do to the sociological reality that a lot of Sri Lankans of all socioeconomic classes have this sense of entitlement, and they have not fully appreciated the modern conception of what a right is, and that it's inherently tied to an obligation on their part as well, and is more space to do something, is more negative liberty, as opposed to something that they are owed unquestioningly and unconditionally?
It's a very important question. I think two thoughts on this, right? One, and this maybe has been colored by the Indian experience in this, I think the question of, you know, and the distinction you're pointing to is a very important one between rights and entitlements. But the sense to which people feel entitled in a society is often a function of what its elites do, right? So if you're in a highly unequal society where you see the rich and powerful get away with breaking the law, right? That sense of entitlement will grow in all society, right? So partly it's a natural reaction to that. But more importantly, I think there's a reciprocal relationship between the two, right? And you know, some of our societies can sometimes get trapped, I think again, it's more true of India probably than Sri Lanka, a kind of vicious circle, right? Which is, I often feel a sense of obligation to those institutions where I have the confidence that those institutions will serve me well, right? Even in our lives, right? We sometimes have contempt for the state, we sometimes have contempt for politics, but there are institutions we respect. So the question of when does a sense of obligation arise, right? I mean, you might say the chicken and egg story, that you can't have effective rights without people having a sense of obligation. On the other hand, they don't acquire a sense of obligation unless they see their rights actually being respected. So I actually think it's a much more reciprocal relationship between the two, right? Which is, you know, this vicious circle, the gentleman asked about taxation. Often the excuse for not paying taxes is, we don't respect our institutions, we don't trust them to deliver. If we see good examples of delivery, we are actually prepared to pay those taxes, right? So you have to work at both ends of the problem simultaneously. It's not just a kind of moral problem of saying people should have a sense of obligation. It's that if you show institutional innovation, you're also more likely to actually inculcate a sense of obligation.
Any closing comments, Harsha? Or
thank you very much, Professor Mehta, Professor Samarajiva, and Dr. Harsha. Ladies and gentlemen, they deserve a big round of applause, isn't it? Now I would like to cordially invite Riyadh Rifai, one of the directors of Advocata Institute, to gift a small token of appreciation to our guest speaker, Professor Pratap Bhanu Mehta. Of course, we don't have any silver pins or Parker pens, but of course, we have a small token of appreciation for Professor Mehta. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause. Also, I invite Riyadh to gift a small token of appreciation for our panelists today, Dr. Harsha De Silva, and also for Professor Rohan Samarajiva. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us today. We hope to see you again in our next public lecture. Have a great evening and good night. Thank you very much.